I said good afternoon. Is everybody awake? Celebration of Life. Thank you, Scott Sawyer, for the beautiful music. Woo! Scott has been a family friend and mentor for a long time, over 35 years of music. Thank you for keeping the melody going in our family. My name is Maya Freelon, and on behalf of the family, I welcome you to a celebration of life. You may have noticed the quote on the building now has Phil's name. The quote is as follows: Durham's vitality is built upon the health of our residents and the capacity of our community to foster and enhance the well-being of every citizen. Phil Freelon. Thank you so much to the County of Commissioners and City of Durham and the Durham County Health and Human Services Building, which is a project the Freelon Group worked on. Before Phil passed, he asked to have his celebration here, so we're so happy that you're here with us. You can read the resolution in your tribute booklet. And now we'll have a moment of silence before we start our program. So everybody take a deep breath with me. And let it out. Thank you so much. Pierce?
All right. Thanks, Maya. Big sister. We want to start with a libation. Actually, this is something I learned from Baba Chuck. For all my people in here who are over 55, the elders, I want to ask for your permission to continue. Do we have your permission to continue?
Yes.
Thank you. We're going to open up with a libation in the African tradition. I'm going to pour some water into this plant and recite a few words. And after I recite these words, I want you to, it's a call and response. I want you to respond with Ashe. All right? Let me hear y'all say Ashe.
Ashe.
All right, here we go. Omi Tutu.
Ashe.
Ona Tutu.
Ashe.
Ile Tutu.
Ashe.
All right, that means cool water, cool road, cool home. And thank you, Omi Sade, Bernie Scott, for stepping me through that ritual. My name is Pierce Freelon. Again, I want to thank Scott Sawyer for the wonderful performance. Scott is not mentioned in the program, but he will be on the downloadable version of the program, which you can find at freelon.com. We want to thank, a big thank to Anna, Samantha Powell Jones, Lou, Nina Mason Jones, LSD Jones, and Sons and Funeral Home, ARC Document Solutions, David Glenn, Michelle Lochter, and everyone else who took time to help work on this memorial tribute. Thank you for the wonderful many hours that you put in. Thank you. So I mentioned earlier the website. It is freelon.com, www.freelon.com. So, and we're live streaming right now. So hello to everyone live streaming online. Thank you for being with us here today. I just want to remind everyone to put your phones on silent so you can be here and be present with us. We don't want no beeping, so put your phones on silent. And I'm just going to go over what's going to happen in the program. We are going to hear a new song, a new selection from my mother, Nina Freelon. It's called Just You. It's a song she wrote in honor of my father after his transition. There's a new children's book coming out about Phil Freelon that we're going to present and talk about. In lieu of flowers, Dad has asked that instead of flowers, if you want to make a contribution and show your love and solidarity, please make a contribution to North Star Church of the Arts. This is the legacy project of Phil and Nina Freelon. It's on 220 West Gear Street. It's a wonderful space, and we would like that instead of flowers. After that, we'll talk to my big brother. Dean is going to represent the children and speak on behalf of us, reflections from the eldest sibling. There are going to be some video reflections. We'll hear from my godfather, Bob Powell, who introduced my parents. Then we're going to hear from the kids, Justice, Stella, Ion, Wonderful, August, Nova, Prince, and Zora. We are going to hear from Phil Harrison, one of two of his colleagues, Phil Harrison and Zena Howard, who are both here. We have a special surprise shout-out from our governor, Roy Cooper. Then we're going to hear from Aunt Randy, Dad's sister, Randall Vega, and Freelon Vega, and then there will be the benediction from Bishop Clarence Laney Jr., and we're going to end the afternoon with a drumming processional with Kaike and Baba Teli, Shabu, and friends, and that'll be it. Dad was very specific. We need to end this after 75 minutes, and we intend to follow Ashe. We intend to follow his instructions. For those of you who knew my dad, he knew how he liked things to be done. So we hope to hold ourselves accountable to that. So with no further ado, I would like to introduce my mother, the beautiful, wonderful Miss Nina Freelon.
My beloved Phil is here. I refuse to give him to was, to the past tense, to memory. He is here. And I'm grateful for all that I have with him. As he was lover and friend, supporter, incredible partner for over 40 years. I wrote this song last week, which is why I don't know it. Don't judge me. I have written the words down. Maestro, the track. Sweep away my fear so I fly sweet and true. Love let the voice within my soul sing of my love for you. Every breath a sweeter song, rising melody, not the music or the tune or the candle in this room, just you. The heart of my life, you're the sea and you're the shore, the candle and the flame, you are now and as before.
Well, I don't see anybody else coming to introduce me, so I suppose it's my turn. My name is Dean Freelon. I'm Phil Freelon's eldest son, and I'm going to say a few words on behalf of myself and my siblings, Pearson and Maya. Most of you knew Phil as a friend or a colleague, or perhaps only by reputation. But only the three of us knew firsthand what an amazing job he did as a father. You know, when you add up all his many accolades, awards, and achievements, you start to realize how truly remarkable it is that he could accomplish all that without compromising on the quality of his family life. And he was an exemplary father. He showed me how to be a father. Now notice I said show, not tell. I only got to observe Dad in his professional mode a few times, but by all indications, he was definitely a show rather than a tell kind of guy at work. And the same was true at home. Now, let me share just a few memories my siblings and I share of Dad at home. First, he had a great facility, as those of you who know him professionally know, with anything technical or mechanical. He was great at fixing things. And whenever he fixed anything, he'd get whichever of us happened to be around at the time to loudly proclaim that, quote, Dad can fix anything, end quote. He was also an early adopter of digital media technologies in the 1980s, including camcorders, computers, and internet service, and he shared all of these with his children. My siblings and I have hours of utterly unwatchable footage taken by our elementary-aged selves, with the cameras swaying wildly between the ground and the sky and back again, Dad shouting filming directions to no avail all the while. We had an old PC, and this is during the pre-Windows days, for those of you who remember those days. And Dad used to bring home those flat black 5 1/4 inch floppies, and these had games on them. So our first experiences with computers involved navigating the command line. Now remember, this is all keyboard and text, no graphical interface, and figuring out how to make those games run. And so Dad showed us how to do all of that. Second thing is he really loved the natural world. Those of you who have seen his photographs already know this. We shared this passion on our many treks on the hiking trail surrounding the Eno River, just a few miles north of here. The whole family would pile into the car and spend many a sunny afternoon just walking and enjoying the outdoors in each other's company. Our clearest memories of him during these trips are preserved on home video. With him looking quintessentially early 90s in gym shorts, sandals with socks, and a fanny pack. Yes, that was Dad. Many of our family vacations also took us to outdoorsy destinations, including the Blue Ridge Mountains to the west of here in North Carolina, Pipestem State Park in West Virginia, and Cheyenne, Wyoming, where our arrival must have bumped up the black population by at least a couple of percentage points. but through this exposure to the outdoors, Dad instilled in all three of us a lifelong appreciation of the wonders of the natural environment. All right. Third and last thing. If you ever had the honor of making it to one of Mom and Dad's New Year's Eve parties, they threw 15 or 16 of these over the course of about 25 years, you know how much Dad loved music. I remember the stereo being on almost constantly as a child, and both Mom and Dad exposed us to their distinctive musical tastes. Dad made sure we were all thoroughly acquainted with the best of the Godfather of Soul himself, Mr. James Brown, who was probably his all-time favorite artist. We also heard lots of Earth, Wind, and Fire, Tower of Power, and many other funk and soul powerhouses. But I think what I remember most is his love of 80s and 90s one-hit wonders, and all these songs remind me of him to this day. These include, but are not limited to, Word Up by Cameo, Cantaloupe by Us Three, you know. Funky, funky, right? I know y'all remember this. This Is How We Do It by Montel Jordan, 1995. Never Come Whack on an Old School Track, right? Come On and Ride It, The Train, by the Quad City DJs. And of course, the inimitable Da Dip by Freak Nasty. With which, several years, this song came out in 1997, and several years after that, he would sort of punctuate, you know, something funny that he would say with, I dip, you dip, we dip. I'm so glad it only lasted about 5 or 6 years. And the last thing is, how could I forget how he always made sure that we knew which blue-eyed soul artist had soul and which didn't? I'll just give you two. Hall & Oates, yes. Michael Bolton, absolutely not. all right. I could go on, but Dad insisted that I speak for no longer than 7 minutes, and I might be a little close. So, all I really wanted you to know is that in addition to being a first-class architect, business leader, teacher, mentor, and trailblazer. He also, somehow in all of that, found time to be a loving and attentive father. Thanks, Dad. I love you.
So remembering Brother Phil, I want to thank God for the blessing of my friendship with Phil Freeland. I've known Phil since we were in school together, and the deal was he was always 10 steps ahead of everybody, as we were talking about in the chess game the other day. And so we're all in school, we're at MIT, we're studying real hard, but Phil had figured out that he could work for the same architecture firm that he worked for at NC State while he was at MIT. So when the rest of us were trying to graduate and get a job, Phil's ready to get his license. But part of the blessing was that we graduated and moved to North Carolina together. And so when that happened, as many of you know, I was witness, where are you, Bill? to their meeting, and in fact, Beverly Davenport and I kind of did that together. But from that point on, they shared this gift of making their dreams come true, and Phil and Nina supporting one another does not capture the partnership that they have. We were all young and trying to move ahead professionally and so forth. And Nina was a homemaker. What's she doing? But they had a plan. They had a plan and carefully developed between the two of them that part of this was to have this family with these three young folks here who you now see have grown up to be wonderful people. And part of it was that Phil was gonna move from being practicing architect to working for a large firm in Houston, coming back being vice president of architecture for a firm and starting his own firm. And so, but Phil knew how to not only do this stuff, but ask the right questions, get the right help, figure out things that we couldn't figure out about how to do stuff. And so eventually, he has his own firm and grew it and to all the wonderful things that have happened here. But my favorite memory, and Dean, you kind of stole some of my thunder, is the Freelon home. Just hanging out and watching these kids grow up with reflections of love and spirit that was in their home. The house had serious discussions. There was work that happened related to Durham and our community and the state in that house. But it was also fun. There was the wit of Granny Franny, the bad jokes of Phil Freelon. Sorry, buddy. There was fun and exuberance, but there was a take no prisoners vibe in that house that we carry with us today. And of course, the New Year's Eve parties, Durham Institution, Dean said it all. And then recently there were times of quiet reflection. When Phil and I would get together, we'd play chess. And I just really don't even know how to put the words to it for y'all of just when we would sit with each other and Phil would be preparing me for this day and these days. And, that's what Phil always did. my son Stephen and I and Dean and Phil were together. And at the last meeting on this side, Phil is talking with Stephen and kind of sharing, what are you doing? And, you know, showing, not telling. And so the word is, Phil, thank you for sharing your peace with me. I will, as Nina says, I will hold that one. I will hold that one. And as I noted earlier, Phil and Nina, you can't say one without the other. Their partnership in marriage, family, architecture, singing, and community has borne so much fruit. Dean, Maya, Pierce, and Nina, from Mildred, Stephen, Jade, and me, you know of our love for Phil. You know of our love for you. And you know today we hold you in our arms. And thank you for sharing his life and your life.
Okay, in the difficult act to follow department, and not to mention the difficult act to proceed, you're going to remember me or not as the one between the video and the grandkids, I think. So, I mean, when the grandkids go, it's going to be all over. I think. Drop the microphone. Let's see. I'm going to say a few words about Phil as a design professional, and like everyone else here, you should know that Phil told me exactly what to say, so... He literally called me 2 weeks before he passed, and he told me about this day and what I should say to you. And he said, why don't you dust off the speech you made at Harvard when we established the Freelon Fellowship? And he said, I liked what you said then. that was 3 years ago in Cambridge, and Nina, Phil, and I were at the GSD to announce an endowed fellowship that they and Perkins and Will together had established at the Graduate School of Design. The Freelon Fellowship would pay tuition for students from disadvantaged backgrounds to attend the GST every year in perpetuity, forever. And in fact, I'm hoping she's here because she didn't have a ticket, but Aria, did you get in? Anyway, Aria's here somewhere. Yes, Aria, right over there. It was the first Freelon Fellow, and still is. Fellow 3 years later. Anyway, so now we're going to shift gears, and I also only have 5 minutes, so I'm going to go faster now. But I'm going to shift now into the present tense, and I'm going to read you what I said that day, 3 years ago. And imagine yourself, imagine yourself as an architecture student, you're sort of in your 20s, and you're hopeful for the future. What is it going to be like? So this is going to probably sound somewhat academic and GSD-ish, for those of you who know what that means. Okay, so here we go. We could have called this fellowship by any name if it was just about financial support, but this fellowship has a powerful name, the Freelon Fellowship. It is equally, if not more importantly, about inspiration. Our hope is that Phil Freelon, as a person and as the author of an essential body of work, will inspire Freelon Fellows in perpetuity. Let me tell you why Phil inspires me. Phil links who he is, and I wrote it down so I wouldn't get mushy, but it didn't work then and it's not working now. So anyway, sidebar. Phil links who he is as a person to what he has learned as a professional to produce a uniquely empathetic form of design. This is what I mean. I believe we are seeing a renaissance of the concept of the architect as polymath, multiple-dimensional creative leaders who engage with the totality of life. I'll say that again, totality of life. It's a very old idea, but one that was drastically eroded in the 20th century when architect as creative genius became more the template, an idea promulgated by Ayn Rand and others. Architect who subscribed to this framework of objectivity and ego famously or notoriously developed personal reputations for being headstrong and singularly focused on their own creative output, from me to you. The modern movement was disruptive, and perhaps it required a series of bad boys to be its agents of disruption, but this legacy of singular vision still persists to this day, and often it doesn't fit well with the social fabric around us. In contrast, empathetic polymaths like Phil are fundamentally different and exceptionally well-suited to this time we are in now, because we need to synthesize, integrate, and include in this mixed-up world that needs more mixing. Saying yes to open possibilities is so much more powerful than saying, I have the answer. And remember, just parenthetically, this was 3 years ago. I think it was about a week before the presidential election. And I remember saying to the students at that time that they themselves personally, and also a week later in the voting booth, that they had a choice between narcissism and empathy. And anyway, I won't go there. I went on, I'm almost done, sorry. How is Phil an empathetic polymath? Of course, creative talent is a prerequisite for any great design leader. Phil is massively creative, and design excellence is part of every move he makes, including dancing, apparently. Further, this extends in his photography, furniture making, music, and most vividly, as you can see before you, through his family. Polymaths are also technically restless. We heard about that from Dean. Constantly seeing new ways to make things with natural, imagined, or imagined materials, and Phil is continually obsessed on the fabric, tectonics, and assemblages of the works he creates. They are intellectually curious teachers, writers, researchers, and Phil has taught his entire career, and currently, still in present tense, co-leads our firm's research board. But Phil goes past beauty and intellect. He is deeply committed to social equity, and as he concluded his Loeb Fellowship here at the GSD, now 30 years ago, he focused his newly founded practice in this direction long before social responsibility became something of a trend in design. His body of work is bravely built on the profound cultural dimensions of civil and human rights, inclusiveness, and social engagement. I could go on, but finally, Phil is a true gentleman in the fullest sense of the word, unlike the bad boys of the modern era. Phil's primary mode is one of kindness. This is not a soft or mushy kind of kindness. It's a brave, passionate form of kindness that transcends differences and connects people together. Lonnie Bunch said, he's head of the Smithsonian, was our client at the National Museum, and I believe couldn't make it today, but would have been here if his travel worked out. He said, this museum would not have happened without the generosity and creativity of Phil Freelon. He brought no ego to the project. Instead, he was always saying, this is something bigger than me. This is something honoring our ancestors. Put all together, Phil's combination of strengths make him his own type of polymath, and I believe a superb role model for you and for us all. Not to copy or emulate, but to empower you to realize for yourself in your own way. Personal differences give us unique voices, and Phil's unique voice is a beautiful one. This is why diversity matters so much, And this is the reason why this fellowship seeks to support students from underrepresented communities. We need to broaden the conversation of design in society to make it better, and I believe we can all learn from Phil as someone who has established his own voice and navigated his own path. So just briefly shifting back to right now in this moment, and now I'm done, like the students that we spoke to 3 years ago, I know you will also carry your own inspiration from one of the most complete and distinctive architects and human beings I've known. Thank you. About to do our grandchildren's tribute. We're going to start with a video that was produced by Ion Freelon Asante. Come on over here, kids. You can roll the video. No, we're supposed to wait for the video. It's okay. Well, do you want to tell us anything about the video before it drops?
Well, it's about my grandfather.
The empathetic polymath that we just heard about?
Not really.
Okay. Well, how about this? While y'all are getting the video queued up for...
There's no video?
Okay. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll just go from eldest to youngest and... Justice, do you want to start? Well, first of all, if you look in your program at the second to last page, there's a bunch of photos. Included in that is a drawing of our father standing in front of the Smithsonian. That was drawn by Justice Proctor Freelon. Give him a big round of applause. So, Justice, tell us what you love about your pop-up.
Something I love about him is he has a very creative, like, mindset and brain. And now I know where my dad gets his cheesy jokes from.
Stella, you're next. Stella's gonna sing a song.
Yeah, it's called Dream Keeper. I don't know who it's by. Dream Keeper, Dream Keeper, Dream Keeper, Dream Keeper, Dream Keeper, Dream Keeper. Dream Keeper, Dream Keeper, bring me all your dreams, you dreamers. Bring me all your heart melodies, that I may wrap them in a blue cloud cloth, away from the tear of fingers of the world.
Thank you. You're next up. I'm just going to say something you love about your papa.
I love the fact that he's my grandpa, and I like his jokes a lot.
Okay. So who's next in age? Is it Prince or August? August? Okay, August, what do you love about your
papa? I like about my papa because he likes everything I do for him.
Okay. He likes everything you do for him? Okay. So Prince is going to lead us in a little prayer. Y'all ready for some prayer?
Father God, you have been the nicest guy I ever see. Father God, if you've been so nice, Father God, I know you have been the nicest God I ever seen in my life. You've been so nice and loving, and I love you every morning, every night. I think about my God's been so nice and loving. I know about God. He's been the greatest God I ever seen. He's been so nice twinkle little star, how wonderful you are.
Give her a big round of applause. This is Ion's video.
Hi, everybody. It's Pop Pop.
Thank you, Ion. Give the grandkids a big round of applause.
Thickens. You know, one thing, I have 5 minutes to chat a little bit about and share memories about Phil. And one thing about Phil is that he was very careful about time. And when you go over that one eyebrow, so he's here with that one eyebrow. So I'm going to keep it short but simple. It really is an honor to pay tribute to a man who is a partner, a mentor, a friend to so many. I'm always encouraged by the wonderful attributes Phil represents. And when thinking about the exact words that I can say that truly embody what he is, I'm simply overwhelmed. But when I think about the experiences that I've shared with him over so many years, there are some that are unforgettable in the way that they convey so much about him, often in just a few moments. So the best way for me to talk about Phil is to share a few of these with you. Phil was authentic. I met Phil nearly 16 years ago when I came to North Carolina to discuss the opportunity of working with the Freelon Group. And naturally, of course, I was impressed by the firm's incredible architectural portfolio and its potential for more amazing accomplishments. I was also struck by how extraordinarily professional Phil was. He was very stately with this imposing sort of statuesque-like appearance. Later in the day, I had the opportunity to have lunch with Phil and a few members of his team. He was sharing a bit about his family, discussing Nina's remarkable career as a jazz artist and their shared responsibility in caring for their young children while building their respective careers. I remember a huge smile that came across Phil's face as he described the challenges with styling his daughter Maya's hair. He then blurted out, "Yeah, There were days when her hair would just be jacked up. And it totally shattered this image I had. That was the first time I realized that Phil had this genuine, authentic side to him that was in perfect balance to his more polished image. Phil was also a helper and an advocate. Phil and I worked on several projects together. We traveled to different meetings, different cities. As most of you know, Phil was an exceptionally tall man with this very long gait. And it was not always easy to walk beside him and keep up. He was a consummate gentleman, always consistently mindful of pausing or slowing down, but still, I would often feel like I was a gerbil on a treadmill, just trying to keep pace with him. So one day, I had a good idea. I asked Nina. I said, "Nina, how do you keep up with him?" And her response was simply, "I don't." So I pondered this for a while before I realized a deeper meaning that extended well beyond walking down sidewalks. Many of us learn so much from Phil by following in his footsteps, which were pretty large. However, he never had the expectation that we would keep up with him in lockstep, because he would always reach back, extending a helping hand to allow us all to realize our own goals. Of course, this was implied in Nina's response, "I don't." And as I began to move at a pace more suited for me, without fail, Phil was always there, helping and advocating as often as needed. Phil was calm and optimistic. As many of you know, Phil and I worked together for nearly a decade on the National Museum of African American History and Culture. This is indeed a legacy project that both of us are honored to be a part of its realization. However, as you can imagine, a project of this high profile and complexity is not without its challenges. I recall on one occasion when we were enjoying one of these challenging moments. Many of us, from the design team to the owner to the contractors, consultants, were particularly frazzled. But there sat Phil, calm and collected. So I asked him if he was at all frustrated by everything that was going on. He responded that from an emotional perspective, he said, I try never to get too high or far or too far down. He always had a glass is always full attitude, a very optimistic look on everything. On several occasions, he would say, "Pray about it, and I will too, and let's chat again." And I would think, "Oh dear Lord, just can't I get mad about it first?" But I would always remember his words and try to bring this to bear in difficult times. Finally, Phil was humble and gracious. He was one of the most humble people I've ever had the pleasure of knowing. His personal achievements were not his own. They were the team's. That was his attitude. Phil, as a leader, surrounded himself with great talent. He brought some of the best people to the table and provided a platform for them to excel. He did not choose or chase wealth or fame. To any degree that he obtained these things, it was a natural outcome of who he was. His motives were always coming from a good place, leading at all times with his heart and his values. I miss my dear colleague, mentor, and friend, but I, along with many others, are comforted by trying to carry forth these special qualities in our own life as he did in his. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Governor Roy Cooper. Today, we celebrate the life of Phil Freeline, an innovative architect and teacher of design, a passionate advocate for the arts, a loving husband, father, and grandfather, and a remarkable human being. Phil lives on through the iconic places he helped create, places that celebrate and foster community, including the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History, North Star Church, and the Durham Bulls Athletic Park. Phil also lives on through his amazing wife, Nina, and their inspired family. It's easy to see his legacy through the many ways they participate in the life of our beloved community. We're grateful that Phil Freeline called North Carolina home. Our state is a more creative and a more inclusive place because of his legacy. We'll miss you, my friend.
And I'm here to talk a little bit about Phil's birth family. My two brothers are here, Gregory and Douglas. Where are you, Doug? There. Stand up, guys. And we have family and friends from all over the country who are here today. We grew up in a really sort of wild and crazy family. Our parents were I guess I'll call them sort of socialites. They loved to party. One of our big stories is that on Friday afternoon, my mother was a teacher. He would drop the boys off with my grandmother, drop me off with my great aunt, and they would drive to Chicago for a party. And then come back in time to pick us up, get ready for school, and drop my mother at the schoolhouse door. In time to be in work on time. I don't know if you remember this, Chip, but we spent hours trying to convince Phil that Chip was boy in the Tarzan movies. That he had actually played that part. And we summered on the Cape with the Ramseys, and the Ramsey girls are all here today. And we spent hours trying to hook Phil up with Rob Dobb. That never worked either. And I think it was Phil who coined the term Dougulation control when we were talking about our youngest brother, who was a bit wild at times. But the thing about Phil is that, yes, he was a fabulous architect. I believe he was a genius at architecture. You can see his work in many cities. Certainly it's dotted around North Carolina and Baltimore and San Francisco and Philadelphia, Detroit, all over. And of course, there's his largest achievement, the Smithsonian Museum of African American History on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. But I think his greatest achievement is that he was an architect of relationships. He knew how to build relationships with people and to reach out, and the greatest testimony to that is all the people that are here today and the people who couldn't fit in this room are in another room watching it on television, and the people who couldn't make it because it was too far or whatever, but who wanted so much to be here. And he built those relationships from the ground up. We have our cousins here representing the Sujets and the Robins from Philadelphia, our cousin BB, our cousin Carl. We have the Ramsey girls here from Philadelphia. Now they're all over. We have our Aunt Willadine, who's along with Aunt Connie, the Ramsey mother, is probably our oldest relative, right, Aunt Willadine? Who just wrote a book about their family history. Her daughter, Coralie, and her husband, Greg. One of the stories about Phil is that he was such a true friend. He and Chip were great friends of Aunt Willa Dean's son, Nubbins. Nubbins contracted a disease that debilitated him and disabled him, and Phil and Chip would go and visit him at home, visit him in the hospital. When my husband was suffering with pancreatic cancer, every time Phil was in D.C., he would come to Baltimore to visit Jim in the hospital, and Jim's son, Josh, is here. He was a great mentor and guide and father figure for my children, Andre and Nico and Livy, who are all here today and with their children. He was a builder of relationships, and I think that's the most relationships, of course, with his family, with his wife's family, the Pierces, who are all here today. And that's the way I'll remember him most, as someone who cared about other people and opened his heart and arms to them. And yes, we have his wonderful buildings, but we also have these fabulous memories of what he was in our lives and how he touched us personally. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for loving Phil.
Thank you for your presence here this afternoon. Thank you for loving Phil Freelon. Thank you for loving Nina, Dean, Maya, Pierce, the grandchildren, the siblings. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your love. Phil now sleeps with the ancestors, but he is still with us. He is a part of that great cloud of witnesses. Let us not grieve as those who are without hope. For we know if this earthly house of this tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building not made by hand, eternal in the heavens. Let us not forget the Freelon family. When you drive by the buildings that he designed, pause, teach it to your children and to your children and to your children's children. Thank you for your presence here today. Now let us have the benediction. For the life of Phil Freelon, we say Ashe. For his laughter, love, and legacy, we give you thanks. For his insight, inspiration, impartation, we give you praise and we say Ashe. Thank you for the ways in which Phil has given to our country and to this community. May his acts of service be a lasting light to us all. Great and holy God, be a comforter to the Freelon family. Love them and they shall be loved. Keep them and they shall be kept. Now to the God, through God's Son, Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. And those who believe in me, though they are dead, shall never die. To the only wise God, be glory, majesty, power, dominion, both now and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen and ashe.
Everyone, please remain seated for the family recessional. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being out here, especially those of y'all who are out here in the heat. We really appreciate your presence. We appreciate your presence here, and we look forward to sharing energy and space and vibrations and hugs and kisses with all of you. But just on behalf of our family, we just wanted to say thank you for coming. Everyone inside, thank you for being here. Thank you to the drummers. Give them a big shout out. All right. The family is going to walk out. Feel free to take a look at the gallery exhibition, which is inside. And again, we appreciate you here today. Thank you. Peace.